Hey everybody, and welcome to Brian Rashid Global. Today I'm super excited to have an esteemed friend and guest with us, Pedro Espinoza, my man.
Great to see you, brother.
We met in the Bay Area, San Francisco, and now we are in the Big Apple, New York. Super stoked to talk to you. This guy's a rock star, young immigrant entrepreneur from Lima, Peru.
Yeah.
Started a company called Smiley Go. He is all of, 22 years old?
Correct.
And I just kind of want to dive in. We have a lot of young entrepreneurs that watch the show. So any questions that you guys have, we'll answer anything that we can for you. And so I'm super stoked that you're here, man. How's it to be in New York City? What are you doing here?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm very, very grateful. I'm here for about 10 days.
Yep.
I'll be meeting with IBM, who's our first major Fortune 500 user. As of last Friday, we gave them a trial, so we're really excited.
And so before we get into what Smiley Go does, tell us a little bit more about who you are, where you came from, how did you end up starting this company, and then we'll talk about what Smiley Go is and what that means for IBM.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, Brian. So first, I was born in Lima, Peru. So we have a lot of great food. We eat guinea pigs, cuy. I don't know if you've tried it. It's pretty good.
I have not, but I'm open to it.
Nice. Born and raised in Peru. When I was 17, 18, I applied to a bunch of universities and I got into Berkeley, which I'm very thankful.
Did you apply from Peru?
Yeah.
Okay.
I went to the American School of Lima, so that was very helpful too, you know, in terms of like APs, IBs, and SATs.
Yep.
And then I did business administration at Berkeley at Haas, the undergraduate school of business. Right before that, I did a very short program at Stanford of management science and engineering.
Okay.
And out of a class in Stanford was when I got really inspired to start Smiley Go.
And so tell us, what is Smiley Go?
Sure. It's a platform that helps companies manage their community investments. For example, a company like Shell, you know, it's a global Fortune 500, and they obviously have a lot of stake in the environment and public policy, and they want to make sure they're a good corporate citizen. So they need to fund, visualize, and do the due diligence which nonprofits fit in their mission so they can make a better impact in their community.
And so how do you facilitate that process?
We provide all the nonprofit data of all the NGOs and foundations in North America. So essentially, we use Amazon supercomputers to give them all the data that they want. So revenues, zip codes, congressional districts, board members, who's the president of this nonprofit, and salaries and admin expenses.
So you're giving the companies access to all of this nonprofit data so that they can make more, I guess, sophisticated and strategic decisions around where they give their monies?
Correct.
Okay.
More from a compliance point of view, because banks and financial institutions have the Community Reinvestment Act since the 1970s.
So before Smiley Go existed, Shell or other Fortune 500 companies would basically just say, I'm just going to give money to the YMCA or to Big Brothers Big Sisters of Harlem because I just think that makes sense?
Ideally, and they use spreadsheets, annoying emails, and cold calls, and it's a mess.
And so what have you done to sort of revolutionize that?
We've digitalized everything. So we're not only a yellow pages of the nonprofit data, but they can also budget all their investments.
Yep.
They can visualize the whole US North America map by congressional district or state or zip code. And they can also search all these different investments.
So what are you seeing? What's the landscape? What are you seeing in terms of what are companies excited about investing in? Let's look at it from both perspectives, right? If you're a company executive watching, or if you're a company employee watching, you say, oh, this is cool. I want to bring this to my boss. What kind of opportunities are you going to give these people? On the flip side, for the nonprofits that are like, yo, I really need more money.
Yeah.
What are companies excited about funding so that maybe they can start to figure out how to do more of that to get that money?
Definitely. So our first user was San Jose Water Company.
Okay.
And how they received requests for funding from these nonprofits was through physical paper applications.
Yep.
And now they're super excited because they're receiving all the nonprofit applications through our portal.
Yep.
And they can receive hundreds or thousands of nonprofit requests that are specific. Like, hey, we need $2,000 to do a go-to-school biking program.
Yep.
And so employees.
So you're bringing all of that, you're kind of digitizing all of that and bringing it right to the inbox of the companies, that it's structured in a way that I know exactly the project they need funding for and where that money would, what that money would actually do.
Yeah.
Okay. And as opposed to having your assistant or someone sit there and go through all the nonprofits in New York City and see what kinds of projects they have going on and see if that's aligned with your thing.
Correct.
Right. All right, and then from the nonprofit side, if I have a nonprofit and I want more money, what kinds of things are a lot of corporations funding right now?
So nonprofits are very excited because before there wasn't a common app for all the grant applications. Now you can just submit one single PDF request on our site and it goes to all the good fit companies that can fund them.
And how do you decide? Or how do you decide what are the good fit companies?
We look at the criteria from the corporations and we use algorithms to best match these investments.
Cool. And how big is your team?
We're 7 people.
Great. And you're based out of San Francisco?
Yes.
Okay. So now let's get back to what you're doing here in New York, because I like to keep this super practical for people. But what I'm interested in is, like, how did you find your first client with San Jose Water? How did you find IBM, and what is the thing that you're hoping to do with IBM?
Wonderful questions. First one, we met San Jose Water Company through the Silicon Valley Leadership Group.
Okay.
It's one of the most powerful lobbying organizations in the Bay Area. And I'm a member of their CEO task force and working council. And the vice president of government relations, John Tang, was there as well. And in those meetings, people, you know, introduced themselves, like, what do they do, a 1 minute spiel?
Yep.
And he was like, dude, give me your card. I was like, yeah, likewise. And then we scheduled the demo, and then we scheduled like a trial, and it was pretty straightforward.
Cool. And then with IBM, what are you doing?
So I got introduced by the former CTO of Yahoo to the current vice president of global citizenship and corporate affairs at IBM here in New York.
Yep.
It was really quick. As soon as the CTO introduced me, the VP was like, Pedro, we want a trial. Like, I checked your site. I want to look at the functionalities.
Yep.
And so I told my CTO. My CTO was like, snap, that's a great problem to have. IBM wants your product right now and it's not ready. So we had to do a lot of debugging for the next 24 hours.
Cool.
And then we just gave them the software four days ago.
And so now they're testing it out? And
yes, you're for 3 weeks.
3 weeks. Yeah. And is that a normal thing? You let companies test this out for a month and then?
Yeah.
And then they decide. So talking about being an entrepreneur, but specifically about being an entrepreneur as an immigrant, what are two or three things that you would tell anyone watching that is an immigrant entrepreneur that has led to you being in a position to have this success?
Well, I'm in step by step, as the song says, pasito a pasito.
Yeah. Oh my God, so, I love that song.
A good tip would be definitely network and look at associations and organizations that want to support you.
Yep. How do you know who wants to support you?
Well, you have to talk to people and share them a small one pager or your deck and be, hey, I'm an entrepreneur from Mexico or Peru, wherever you're from, Colombia, and I want to do this. Would you please support me?
Yep. Got it. And number two?
Number two would be always seek for personal mentors. I'm very thankful to Ron Gonzalez, who's the first Hispanic mayor of San Jose.
Yep.
And ever since he joined our advisory board, he's been making introductions to people at PepsiCo, which I'm meeting them next week
here
in New York, and other major Fortune 500 companies.
Fantastic. So leveraging those networks, having people on the advisory board, what would the third thing be?
No one can do it alone. Seek for co-founders. You know, reach out to local universities. The US, I mean, has thousands of universities. I came to the West Coast, so I reached out to Stanford and Berkeley to seek for a founding team, early employees.
Oh, that's interesting. So you got your employees from local universities.
Yes.
And what did that look like? How did you, was it an email that you sent to their career services department, or how did you find those people?
Good question. Through the director of academic affairs, I would.
So you wrote them and said, hey, I'm looking for people for my team. Do you know of anyone that might be? That's an interesting approach. Like, to be honest, it's a great idea, because a lot of people will write or call me and they'll say, like, I'm stuck. I don't know how to get a team. Like, literally, it's kind of shocking to me how many people just have no clue how to get a team. And so, like, that is a really good idea. Academic affairs of universities in your area.
Yeah.
What else?
What else? This year I started doing some early stage investing in small companies. I'm very thankful that my mom's and my dad's, we have a family business in Peru of gas stations and Toyota dealerships.
Okay.
So I'm sort of taking lead on the M&As and like the acquisitions for them.
Cool.
So I invested in a small company called Kiwi. They're doing food delivery with robots. And it's a pretty cool company. The co-founder of Groove Shark just invested in them as well.
Cool. That's awesome. So Do we have any questions coming in on the feed that you guys can see? I know it's hard to see some stuff. Do you guys have any questions here? Because so the question, just in case we can't hear it on the show or on the camera, was what was the most challenging part of your journey?
I think getting the first check was the hardest part.
Definitely.
I met Frank Baxter, really funny. I was in the cafeteria of UC Berkeley, and I saw this very tall guy, man who's like 80 years old and wearing a suit. My mom would always tell me, surround yourself with the best people, you know, people who are very well dressed, like you. And, you know, I sat next to him, literally. And I was like, hey, like, what are you up to? And he's like, oh, I have a board meeting because I'm a trustee of the University of California Berkeley Foundation.
Yep.
And I was very impressed. I was like, wow. And he, you know, he asked me, like, you're a student, where are you from? I said, Peru. And he said, no way. I was the U.S. ambassador to Uruguay during Bush's administration.
Wow.
And he gave me his card. We started speaking Spanish. And I would send him updates. And then eventually he wrote a check.
Fantastic. Fantastic. So, you know, what I'm hearing from you is it's a lot of people involved in this success, right? So, and it's the same thing for me, from the team to an advisory board to just people that I love that are in my life. So I think that's fantastic. Any other thoughts? Where else can we find more information about you?
Same. You know, I've been very thankful to my family, my mentors, my coaches, our advisory board. Yeah, you can find more info at www.smileygo.com.
Got it. You got the URL.
Yeah. And also my personal site for speeches and stuff, it's www.pedroespinoza.com.
Cool. Yeah, and you do a lot of speaking kind of all over the world at this point, right?
A little bit,
I've been following you for the last couple of years and you're speaking. And what do you usually speak about?
Entrepreneurship, startups 101, how to fundraise, how to go to market strategies, how to network.
Cool. Excellent. Any other questions that you guys have that we have coming in? We have one on the... Santa, go ahead.
Okay, what is your vision for Smiley Go and yourself long term?
Vision for Smiley Go and yourself long term.
Wow. Smiley Go would be, we want to be the number one software as a service company that issues the most grants. Right now, the market leader is Cyber Grants, and I believe they have over 1,400 companies using them.
Wow.
And then a personal one. I love public speaking, public service, community service, and I would really aspire to be run for office in the future.
I totally see you running for office.
Either like governor of Florida or senator of Florida.
Why Florida?
So we first immigrated to Miami.
Oh, okay.
When I was one.
Okay.
But then we came back to Peru. It's a long story.
Florida's like near and dear to your heart, or what?
Yeah, I love Miami. Like my neighbors were Brazilians, Argentinians. Would play soccer all day. It was really good.
It's funny. That's funny. All right, cool. Well, I think just kind of recapping everything that we've learned today, surround yourself with good people, find your first client, and have just like, you have a great disposition, you have a great positive outlook, great positive attitude, very magnetic. Surround yourself with good people, find the people that believe in you, even if you're young. Oh, by the way, I think this is interesting. A lot of people write me in and say, Brian, I'm only 19, I'm only 20, I'm only 21, I'm only 22. How do people take me seriously? What do you tell those people?
I think you don't need a title to be a leader. Same thing, you don't need an age to be a leader.
Yeah.
People have to value you for your responsibility, for your actions, right?
Yep.
If you meet someone, the way you speak, the lingo, the diction, how prompt you are, the way you present yourself is always good.
So I think like for me, the most inspiring thing aside from the work that you're doing, it's like if you're an immigrant and you're young and you're telling me that you can't win in America because you're an immigrant and you're young, then I just don't believe you. And here's a perfect example of why. So like, for me, that's really exciting that you're on this show because you are an example. And please reach out to him if you feel like, oh my God, I am an immigrant and I'm young and I don't know what to do. Like, this is a good success story and he's really making it in the Valley and he's, you know, now at this point coming out to the East Coast, speaking all over the world. So I just think that we live in this world now. Like, if you need permission from someone to do something, and if that permission is based on you being 35 or 40 or 45, you don't need those people anyway. Like there's such a, and I'm sure you're seeing this now, right? Like IBM is calling you out. Like IBM called you out because you solved the problem for them because your software is actually helping them do something better. And I bet IBM doesn't give two craps about you being 22 or you being from Peru. Like, for me, it's the most exciting time ever to be an entrepreneur, and you're a perfect example of that. Like, just do good work, solve problems, stop making excuses. I actually think that because you're an immigrant and because you're young, you have that level of hunger that I do a lot of speaking at CUNY schools. Cool. And the CUNY system is one of my favorite school systems in the country because it's like 50% immigrant, 50% first-time college students. And I look at them and I say, you guys actually have an insane competitive advantage to all of like the fifth or sixth generation people that have been here, that have accumulated a lot of family money, that go to Harvard. Like, I tell them, you guys have an insane competitive advantage. So like, embrace that. Please don't think that because you're 22 or you're from Peru or Mexico or Africa or whatever, that you have that you are waiting in line for someone to choose you in America. It's just not true. Surround yourself with good people, solve a problem, and from there, you will find that you are irreplaceable regardless of it, all the other stuff, right?
Yeah.
So, dude, thanks for coming in. I really appreciate it. Hit this guy up if you're ever looking for a good speaker, if you're ever looking for a good mentor, if you're ever looking for a good whatever. He is doing his thing. So, guys, thanks for checking it out. It's your hour, it's your life, it's your dreams to go get it, because if you don't, nobody else will. Have a good day.